All right, everybody, welcome to another episode of Ask the Expert with the Martin Eiden team. Side note, I've been a little shout out for Bel Air Mountain here. I'm skiing with the family today. So really nice time doing that, which I'm very happy to do. But the most important thing right now is we have Alex Mahgoub as our host, and he's going to be interviewing Danny Sassoon of Citizens Bank to give us all the updates of what's happening in mortgage land in 30 minutes or less. So, Alex, take it away.
Martin, thank you very much. Hello, everybody, and welcome to, you know, number 800 of Ask an Expert. And today we have the one and only, the man, the myth, the legend, Danny Sassoon, an amazing mortgage banker at Citizens Bank. Danny, how are you?
I'm good, Alex. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How did you get time to even do this, right? Aren't you like crazy, crazy busy right now?
Yeah, but you know, you locked me down 3 weeks ago, told me, Danny, just 30 minutes, you can do it. I was like, okay, just for you.
Kind of like
just
a rate lock.
Super broker. Exactly.
Good. Thank you so much. So Danny, before we get started and diving into everything about mortgages, I want to know a little bit more about you. I think you might have had a second baby recently. Is that true?
Yes. Yes. Thank you. So I did just have my second child. She's a 3 month old. Her name is Arlene. My oldest is a 3 year old boy. His name is Ralph, and they're just the best. They're definitely just the best. My sleeping, you know, it was down already with just being so busy with work, and now it's just non-existent. I'm learning to just live awake 24 hours a day.
But I'm sure we have to thank your wife as well for all the work that she's doing too, right?
Yes.
So talk to me a little bit about your adventure or your journey in your career, because you haven't always been at Citizens, right?
Correct. I'm going on 2 years at Citizens in a couple of months. And prior to being at Citizens, I was a mortgage broker at a couple of different companies for 9 years. So I had that side of things by being a broker for 9 years. And then I saw the market start to shift. And I knew that to better service my clients, I needed to work for a bank directly. And 2 years ago, that's when I decided to make the move over to Citizens. And I can say 2 years later, it's definitely the best decision that I made for my career and for my clients that I'm able to service better.
Perfect. Yeah. Danny works with a lot of my clients. For what it's worth, everyone that's listening, I think Danny is hands down the best mortgage banker you could ever deal with. I promise you. But since we're talking a little bit about this, a lot of people always have questions. What's the difference between a mortgage broker and a mortgage banker? And because you've done both jobs, can you really walk us through the main differences and why someone may want to work with a broker over a banker and vice versa?
Sure. So the main difference is a mortgage broker is not necessarily tied to one particular bank. A mortgage broker is going to have a plethora of banks or investors or credit unions to choose from, whereas a mortgage banker, typically if they're working directly for one bank, just has that bank to choose from when they're shopping around for their clients. There's not really much shopping. It's just what that bank has. So what are some basic pros and cons? Why wouldn't you always just go to a broker? Because it sounds like they can always get you more. The problem that, and the reason why I moved from being a broker to working directly for a bank, is that in recent years, less and less banks are actually working with brokers than what they used to. When I started in the business, we had over 40 to 50 different banks to choose from as brokers, including the bigger names out there. And then over the years, a lot of the bigger banks stopped working with brokers and actually started to incentivize buyers to go to them directly, because banks decided that they wanted mortgages more, because mortgages are usually the biggest financial investment somebody's going to have. So in a bank's mind, hey, if we have your mortgage, we can maybe be your bank. So they want to use mortgages as ways to get their to get more clients. So they incentivize them by offering better rates, lower fees. And that's why I saw a lot of my clients bypassing me as a broker and going directly to a bank. So that's why I made that shift.
Amazing. And, you know, since we're talking a little bit about this, I'm just curious, why would someone want to work with you at Citizens Bank versus maybe a larger bank like a Wells Fargo or JP Morgan or something like this? Oh, I bank at Citibank. I'm just going to use them. What would you say to someone like that?
So that's a great question. And that's usually one of the first calls I get is, oh, you know, I walked into my bank. I walked into Chase. And yeah, I decided to ask them about a mortgage. So the reason I would say that, and it actually goes to the reason why I chose Citizens. When I was looking at a bank where I wanted to be, I actually took an inventory of where my clients were going. When I was losing clients and they were getting better terms elsewhere, I took a real look over the last year and checked to see where were these clients getting their mortgages from? And more, you know, it was spread out, but more often than not, the mortgages were coming from Citizens. So I started to look into why. And Citizens, being a smaller bank, has flexibility to do more creative deals than bigger banks. And that's what I needed, especially as a broker. When I was a broker, I was able to do all kinds of deals. So I needed to still go with that and still be able to be nimble and have flexibility when getting a loan approved. So that's why I chose Citizens, because the flexibility of being small plus being competitive in interest rate to the bigger banks is just the perfect fit.
Great. And then real quick, just, you know, that person that really wants to work with their bank, what would you say to them? Do you think it's a good idea to shop around?
I always think it's a good idea to shop around. And there could be benefit to working with your bank. There are some banks that as private clients, you might get some type of incentive. So it's always good to ask, you know, don't drive yourself crazy calling 20 different banks, but call one, call two, call three, and see where you can get the best deal. If the one you're banking with is one of them, you'll know. They'll present you with an offer. It doesn't hurt to ask, but it doesn't mean it's always the best option.
Yeah, exactly. And the way I would kind of put it is, if you were looking at a hotel or, you know, a rent-a-car or something like that, or even airlines, you would comparison shop. You know, you'd go to Kayak, you go to Orbitz, you go to cheaptickets.com or whatever, and see what kind of pricing you're getting. Because why? You want to save money. You want the best deal possible. And also, you want the best experience possible. So even before you were at Citizens, I would refer you clients because I always knew they'd be in great hands and that you would take care of them. You would answer all of their questions. So when I tell buyers to shop around, yes, you want the best rates and the best terms, but ideally you also want the best service. You want someone that's going to be there for you and take you from A to Z and not disappear and not be available. So work with Danny. Okay, cool. So this is perfect. The market has done a complete 180 from the fall. I think all of us in this industry in New York City were overwhelmed, we're exhausted. And friends of mine, you know, people that were looking to buy last year, 2 years ago, 5 years ago, people are reaching out to me and it's a little bit overwhelming. And they're like, I'm ready to buy, let's start looking at stuff. And when I say to them, I say, okay, that's great. I'm happy to get started, but have you spoken to a mortgage banker to get a pre-approval? And they go, oh no, I'll do that later. Let's start seeing places now. What would you say to them? Why should maybe they speak to you first before even looking at places?
Well, I can actually turn around and ask you the same thing. And you're probably seeing this on the listing side. There's times now where a listing agent will not even allow an appointment to somebody that's not pre-approved. So let's take a step back and let's talk about what the pre-approval is and why it's so important. So when a buyer is getting pre-approved, what they're doing is speaking with a lender in order to get vetted. They're getting their credit vetted, they're getting their income and their assets vetted. We're going to look at them and see what are they qualified for? How much of a mortgage can they take out? And why this is so important is because, especially now when we're still in a pandemic and there are still a lot of hesitant sellers allowing people to come into their homes to look at it. So they want to know that somebody's serious. What's the best way to know that somebody's serious? If they've gone through a vetting process with the bank, you know, and it's not a grueling process, but it's not a snap of a finger. They know that, okay, this person's doing their homework. They're serious and they want to potentially buy this home because they went through those steps and they've done it recently. So they you know, maybe their feet might be to the fire and they want to go ahead with this. So that's why it's so important. Whether the seller requires it to just be allowed in the home is one thing, but they will definitely require it if you're going to be putting in an offer. So that's just from, let's say, a requirement standpoint. But what about being a buyer and putting time in, getting emotionally invested? When you're looking at properties, sometimes you get it, you know, more than sometimes, you get attached, especially if you find the place you love. And then what if after that fact, you found out that that place doesn't work for you because you may not qualify for financing? You might be just so, you know, heartbroken or derailed that you decide you don't want to shop anymore because you just got so invested in something and now it seems like it got taken away from you. So it's always good to know beforehand what your price range should be before you even go down that road.
Yeah.
I just wanted to add on that, Danny, that, you know, with rates so low, people may be surprised on what their buying power actually is, that they can afford a lot more than perhaps they thought they could.
Absolutely. Yeah. Somebody would tell me, hey, I'm looking for apartments around $800,000. And I say, where did you get that number? Oh, it just seemed like right for us. So on our conversation, I don't cap them at that number. They say, hey, look, let's see if that number is the right number. Let's see if that number is too low. Let's see if that number is too high. We're going to create a budget and we're going to hone in on a price range that is perfect for you. And now, you know, you don't have an arbitrary number. You have a perfect number that suits you.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why I always tell buyers, you speak to a banker to understand what you can afford. You never need to go up to your full budget, but you want that vetted so you're not looking at properties that you can't afford. And you also don't want to be looking at properties that are very below your budget because maybe you could get something better. And I've found that New Yorkers always want something better. So that's good input. You know, I think with mortgages, the reason people get confused are there are terms thrown around that they don't fully understand. So let's talk about, I think, two of the main ones. I hear a lot of like pre-qualification, and sometimes I hear what we've been talking about, a pre-approval. Can you talk about the difference between those two?
Absolutely. So a pre-approval is stronger than a pre-qualification. Why? What's the difference? A pre-qualification is simply when a buyer has a conversation with a lender and tells them how much money they earn, how much money they have in the bank, and what their credit is based on their knowledge. That's a pre-qualification. That's all it is. It's a conversation. Nothing was substantiated or proven to the lender. So a pre-approval is when the bank actually looks at their income, requesting pay stubs, W-2s. They look at their assets, looking for bank statements to see that they have the money that they said they do, and we pull a credit report. This is the main difference. We see it all. So when we issue a letter saying you've been pre-approved, it's not just because we had a 20-minute conversation and you told me how much you earn. It's because I did the work and I was and able to verify. And that verification, is that stamp of approval, is worth so much more than just that phone conversation.
Agreed. Whenever buyers tell me they've been pre-qualified, I get very nervous.
It's worth as much as the revenue financial form they give you.
What'd you say?
It's worth as much as the revenue financial form that they give you.
Yeah, exactly, right? So I'm curious, when you're doing this pre-approval process, what types of documents do you need to see?
Sure. So if somebody is salaried, then, and you know, they simply work for somebody, we ask for their pay stubs, most recently for the last month. We ask for their W-2s for the last year. and we ask to see their bank statements to see how much money they have in the bank, and we run a credit report. Not too bad. If somebody is self-employed, there's a main distinction. If somebody is self-employed, we ask to see their tax returns so that we can see how they report their income on their tax returns. And we need to analyze those tax returns to see how that income looks. That's the main difference in the documentation that we ask for, is if someone's self-employed, we look to see the taxes.
Yeah, I got you. And then with a pre-approval, how much time does it take? Can you do a pre-approval in an hour, or does it take a few days? What do you suggest?
So it depends how quick a buyer can get documents over. The initial conversation can be anywhere half hour to an hour. And then if they can pull together documents, which some people takes them half hour, some people take them 2 days, depending if they're downloading different statements. But once they turn those documents over, which, like I said, one to two days, I would turn around that pre-approval letter in the same day, maybe 2 days.
Got it. Yeah, you work very fast, I've noticed, because you don't sleep. something I hear all the time from buyers, about shopping around and just seeing where they can get the best terms. Oh my God, they're going to run my credit at more than one place. I won't be able to buy after they run my credit more than once. You have any feedback about this? Will their credit be destroyed?
They will not be destroyed. It is a common myth that credit pulls have a negative impact on somebody's credit when it is a mortgage pull, even multiple mortgage pulls. So the credit algorithms, they look at what kind of debt you're seeking, and mortgages are considered good debt. So when you're getting an inquiry from a mortgage company, it does not hurt you. Whereas if you're looking for a new credit card or a department store card, those are considered bad debt. So when you get those inquiries, yes, it will hurt your scores. So now what about multiple mortgage pulls? That's just the credit algorithms reading you shopping for a mortgage, which is totally healthy. And you can have multiple mortgage companies run your scores and it will not have an impact.
I feel like you should say that twice. I've had so many buyers freak
out.
Well,
you know what I will say?
Yeah.
Well, what I will say is actually I've seen some type of method from certain mortgage brokers where they'll tell, if they're the first person to speak to a client, they'll say, yes, it actually does hurt your credit. So only have one company pull it to try and like lock them down. And to me, I'm the opposite. If I'm the first person, I encourage them. Yeah. I say, hey, you can definitely have your credit run by me or somebody else. It won't hurt you.
That's why I like to work with you, Danny. You're real, you're honest, fully transparent, and knowledgeable. You know this stuff inside and out, and you give people the real deal. So thank you so much. I'm curious. It sounds great, this pre-approval stuff, but why would someone maybe not be able to get a mortgage?
So I usually like to tell people not now instead of no, if someone isn't qualified. So it really depends on everyone's situation, but the bank has certain criteria that need to be hit if they're going to give someone a mortgage. Someone needs to have sufficient credit. So if someone had a credit problem in the past where their credit scores are below the bank's minimum, it may take them 3 months, 6 months, a year or so in order to get their credit score to where it needs to be. So we take that time. I can set them up with a credit professional to help them with their scores, and they build that over time. So then maybe they're not going to be pre-approved today, but we put them on a path to where they could be pre-approved.
Got it. Yeah, and I love that. Not now, not yet, but we'll get you ready for next year. And in light of that, I know me and you have kind of been speaking a little bit, and I'm someone that is 100% commission-based, and I'm going to be filing taxes a little bit sooner than I really want to. And you said to me, Alex, but before you file your taxes, let's talk. And what's the reasoning behind that? I think you kind of mentioned it earlier, but I would love to kind of share this for anyone who's maybe on a 1099.
Sure. So for anybody self-employed, the way that the bank analyzes their income is by looking at the net income after expenses. So if somebody gets a 1099 and that 1099 was $100,000, and you ask them, how much money do you make? They may say, I make $100,000. But now when that 1099 goes to their creative accountant, whose job is to make sure that they don't pay taxes on that full $100,000, when we see a tax return, all of a sudden that $100,000 starts to dwindle and dwindle and dwindle. And before you know it, it's $25,000 on the tax return. So now when you show that tax return to a bank, they don't say you make $100,000. They say you make $25,000. So that, and when you're looking to get a mortgage and you're showing $25,000 worth of income, how much do you think a bank's going to lend you?
Not a lot of money. I don't think you can buy a house in Ohio on that income, right?
maybe a garage.
Not New York City. All right. Yep. Yeah. Thank you for that. And so look, I come to you, I get pre-approved for a mortgage. Do you only have like one size fits all kind of mortgage, or are there different options? Can you talk about that at all?
Sure. There's different options depending on what a buyer's needs are. There are certain options that we have for medical professionals where we allow them to make a lower down payment than for a conventional mortgage. We have certain loan programs where buyers can potentially put down maybe only 5 or 10% as opposed to the traditional 20% down. And Citizens also has a great construction loan program. If someone was looking at a fixer-upper, you know, there's a lot, even though, you know, you're going to one bank, there's still a menu of products. And that's one of the main things I love, you know, being at Citizens, there's just a lot to offer, and it's definitely not a one size fits all.
Yeah. And I think, you know, you mentioned it earlier, but Citizens being a smaller bank, being more flexible, more nimble, more creative, and you know, being an expert in this world, you can kind of listen to what someone's saying, look at their financial picture and maybe, you know, educate, inform them, but maybe guide them in choosing the right product for them. So that's super helpful. You know, you mentioned already the various down payments, and I do get into conversations with a lot of buyers about that. Talk a little bit about some of these affordability programs, I guess, and maybe touch on mortgage insurance if you can, just briefly, so people can just hear a little bit more about that.
Sure. So the tried and true, the old traditional, is 20% down. That's what everyone's parents taught them they need to put down when they're buying a house. And while sometimes that is the preferred method, in New York City, co-ops aside, that's not always the most realistic method, where property prices and 20% down payments often clash. So for somebody ready to buy a house but doesn't have that 20% down, there's options, whether it's 15, whether it's 10, and in certain situations, even if it's 5%, that they can still get into the market and own real estate here. And you alluded to it. There's something called private mortgage insurance. This is an extra insurance that the bank would have somebody take out when they put down less than 20%. This insurance is sort of a protection because the bank views this as a little bit more risky, somebody putting less down. Now, what's great is that in the last couple of years, the cost of private mortgage insurance has really come down to where I've seen more 10 or 15% down payments in the last couple of years than I did in almost my first 9 years in this business, because it's more affordable with that low private mortgage insurance. So people can hold on to their money, take advantage of these low rates, or just get in with what they have. And it's definitely a tool for someone not needing, or someone that doesn't have 20%.
Great. That's great information. Thank you. We've kind of, you know, Martin mentioned it earlier in the call, and I think we've mentioned it a couple of times now, but I'm hearing a lot about interest rates. I hear that they're at all-time lows. You know, maybe they've been at all-time lows for a while. They keep going down, but talk to me about interest rates. Why does it matter?
Sure. So interest rates are historically low. They are not all-time low. And that is new as of the last couple of months. Throughout 2020, the arrow was only pointing one way. It was down, it was down, it was down. And starting now in 2021, there's been more optimism in the market, more stimulus, perhaps inflation, we'll see. And this has caused interest rates over the last couple of months to come up a little bit. Now, we all have to take a step back because the interest rates were a few months ago, let's say around 2.5%. I shake my head when I hear that rate. Now the rates may have gone up. Let's say they're 3%. A 3% mortgage rate is still an all-time historically low rate. And this is so important for buyers. You know, some buyers say, oh, I can't believe the rates went up in the last month. Well, let's look at where rates were 2 years ago or 3 years ago. And let's look at, you know, the likelihood. Are they going to go back down? Or in a year from now, do we think rates might be a little higher? What's more likely? We don't know what's going to happen. But more likely than not, a rate a year from now will probably be higher than today. So how does this affect someone who hasn't bought yet and they're trying to figure out their budget? Well, it's important to know that every 1% change in interest rate affects somebody's mortgage payment by a little over 10%. I'll say that again. Every 1% change in rate affects payment by 10%. So somebody that had a $4,000 a month budget, and if now the interest rate just went up by 1%, what they were going to get for $4,000, it's now going to cost them almost $4,500. It's a huge difference.
Yeah.
So Martin's right. Rates are low. Even though they're not as low as they were 2 months ago, they're still amazing. And it's definitely an opportune time.
So buy now.
Buy now.
and compared to even, you know, 10, 20 years ago, the rates are significantly lower. Like in the 80s and 90s was like 10%, wasn't it? It was like significantly higher.
18% even.
Ah, I just had a heart attack. So guys, money is cheap. If you've ever thought about buying, now's the time. Talk to Danny. You know, since we're talking about interest rates and the rates changing, this is, I think, a great time. What's an interest rate lock?
Sure. So, and that's a question I even get as early as the first time I talk to somebody. Oh, so what's your rate today? And can I lock it in? So when you lock in a rate, that's when you secure that rate for your property. The time that you do that is when you have a property. So when you're just starting to look, you're subject to whatever the rates are. And until you actually have a contract on a place that you're buying, you're still subject to any day-to-day change, for better or for worse. But once you have that contract, that is when the lender will secure your rate. And ultimately, when you close on the home a couple of months later, you're going to have that rate that you locked when you signed the contract, and you have that for the rest of the mortgage.
Great. Thank you. So we're running out of time here. We just have 2 minutes left. I have more questions, obviously, but maybe for some of the more technical ones, people can reach out to you directly. But as we wrap up, I just wanted to hear, do you have any awesome success stories or little anecdotes from what has been a truly incredible year of pandemic and now we're waiting out of it? Yeah, anything that happened that you want to share that might be insightful or interesting or whatever?
Sure. So this was obviously a crazy year for everybody. And what we found was during this year, a lot of lenders changed guidelines just like that. And that affected people that were already applied, about to apply. So one quick story is just that I got a call literally at the 12th hour. Someone that had been in contract for 3 months, and at the drop of a hat, their lender changed their guidelines and they no longer fit these guidelines. And while we also did change some guidelines, being smaller, we still have more lenient guidelines, and we were able to take in that application and we were able to close for this person. Now, you have to realize they were in contract for 3 months, which means that their deposit was on the line even though the bank had changed the guideline. So if they didn't find a solution to close, their deposit they put up upon contract would have been at risk. So this was where, you know, we got lucky that we didn't change the guideline and we were able to help them.
Wow. So you really are a super banker. Yeah.
Takes a super broker to know one.
This is how I want to finish off. Any predictions or takeaways for buyers about the market? Where do you think, where do you see the market going in the next 3 to 6 to 9 months?
Well, I believe that the real estate market is heating up. The stats will show it. Your Instagram will show it. It's no joke. The real estate market is heating up and it's not even spring. I mean, today's spring, but we're going to see a lot more inventory. And with the interest rates where they are now, it really, and we feel like we've been saying this a while, but they're really, I don't know if there's been a better time than to get out there and get something than right now.
Yeah, beautiful. Well, I'm telling everyone, the sooner you buy, the better. But you got to love it. Don't buy, you know, a hunk of junk. And that's the end of the show. Danny Sassoon, Citizens Bank, thank you so much. You were amazing. I'm going to kick it over to Martin to wrap us out.
Oh, Alex, awesome job interviewing today. Really, really great. And Danny, thank you so much for your valuable time, for sharing us with some insight and everything. So everybody, thank you again for tuning in to Ask the Expert series with the Martin Eiden team. And we'll see you next Thursday at 1 o'clock. Danny and Alex, hold on as we